OK, could I invite members who are leaving the chamber to do so as quickly and as quietly as possible as we move on to the final item of business this afternoon, which is a members' business debate on motion 12617 in the name of Oliver Mundell on putting Langholm on the map. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put. I'd invite those wishing to participate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible. And I call on Oliver Mundell to open the debate around 7 minutes. Mr Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While a day out of Langholm is a day wasted, I am delighted to have secured this debate today and have support from across the Chamber to do so. It is an opportunity to put Langholm on the map, in the Scottish Parliament at least. Langholm is a proud community, and rightly so, with a rich and equally vibrant, a rich past and equally vibrant present. The Muckletoon, as it's known locally, is said to have taken its name from the many large textile mills once based there and the booming population and bustle that accompanied. Sadly, the subsequent years have seen many changes as this and other traditional industries have declined, with only a handful of connected businesses remaining. But one thing is for certain, the sense of community, heritage and spirit fostered over the years has not left and, if anything, has been reignited in recent years. Community efforts are now firmly focused not on halting decline, but on reversing it. Rare credit from me where it's due, but a visit from John Swinney pre-COVID, whilst not delivering the funding many, including myself, had hoped for, did focus minds and has eventually led to the formation of the Langholm Alliance and Community Forum, which have brought the whole community together. This is very much a community-driven effort, much like the Langholm Moor buyout and many other success stories. But again, there can be no downplaying the importance of support on an ongoing basis from the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency, which has been invaluable in funding and roles to coordinate this activity. Following a meeting on Thursday where the community hosted South of Scotland Enterprise Chair Russell Griggs, it was helpful to be able to ask for the Minister's support in addressing the very real concerns of Langholm that, because of the success of the Langholm Alliance, SOCI might now be looking to pull the plug. This would be entirely the wrong decision and presents poor value for money for taxpayers when just another 12 months of support at around £50,000 would give a number of key projects, such as the old primary school hub, a real prospect of being delivered. I would be grateful for confirmation this evening that the Scottish Government will take an interest in securing the support the community deserves. Presiding Officer, it would be easy to fill the remainder of this contribution many times over, talking about Langholm and the many projects, individuals and community groups that make it Langholm. Some of these are touched on in my motion, but it barely scratches the surface. The town has, among other things, been called Scotland's chili capital due to the number of members of its chili growing club. And that's before we even get on to well-advanced plans to move into a new brand of horticulture with a large medicinal cannabis factory, a facility for growing cannabis situated nearby, entirely legal for sniggering colleagues behind. Langholm is many things, but it's always full of surprises and new ideas and new thinking which sit alongside its many proud traditions and customs.
Jackson Carlow.
I just wonder whether Mr Mundell would like to declare whether there's any personal interest in the cannabis factory in Langholm.
Oliver Mundell.
Mr Carlow makes an interesting point and shares where available to the community, but I declined to take them up, primarily because I felt it would limit me in my ability to lobby the Home Office for a licence and the Scottish Government for the financial support needed to build what is an incredible facility that will bring jobs and opportunities to the community. But looking to the past and to some of the historic customs and traditions that make Langholm special, the most notable of these is undoubtedly its historic Borders Common Riding, which is truly Langholm's greatest day and a spectacle to behold. And it is best experienced on horseback, and it remains one of my own personal achievements to have successfully ridden the Common Riding, including the gallop up the Kirkwynd as a member of the Scottish Parliament. I have committed to doing so again, but only on the condition that Emma Harper takes part too. And this seems an appropriate time to thank her for supporting my motion, and I know that she had wanted to speak tonight but is away on British Irish Parliamentary Assembly business. But I'm sure if Emma had been here, she would have been willing to confirm her willingness to take part, and I'm sure to catch her later in the week. Langholm also has another major claim to fame as the ancestral home of Neil Armstrong, the first man to walk on the moon. It's something the town remains very proud of, and they were honoured to make Armstrong a free man of Langholm during a very special visit to the town in 1972. This relationship has continued through Neil's sons and their families who were back in Langholm recently. And a new proclamation of kinship from Wapakoneta, Ohio, Armstrong's birthplace, followed and was unveiled a couple of weeks ago. Perhaps ironically, in the context of this debate, the famous 1972 visit even resulted in the Chicago Tribune publishing a front-page news story featuring a map of the United Kingdom showing only London and Langholm. Presiding Officer, this fact takes me neatly on to the key ask following this debate, because for all its many attractions and accolades, Langholm appears to have been forgotten when it comes to road signage. On the near-hour drive between Longtown and Hoyk, or equally on the whole M74 motorway, you'd be forgiven for thinking that Langholm doesn't exist. It's absent from major directional signage, and there's very little to tell you about its visitor attractions and facilities that are clustered around what is a major population centre for those who live and work in the Eskdale Valleys and in Langholm itself. It might be small in terms of population numbers to someone sitting behind a desk in Scotland's urban central belt, but Langholm matters to the people that live there and has so much to offer. The Langholm Alliance that I mentioned earlier and many individuals and other organisations have been working tirelessly to promote the town, and they are represented in the gallery this evening by Anthony Lane, who's been working hard alongside Sharon Tolson to drive forward the road signage project. While there has been some progress south of the border, delivering some new signs between the M6 and Langholm, and a solitary new sign near Annan, efforts on the A7 in Scotland and on the M74 at Junction 21 have hit a roadblock. We have been told that Langholm isn't a primary destination, therefore it doesn't get to go on the signs. This characterisation is insulting, and even if it does conform to technical guidance, it seems overly officious when there is plenty of room on the signs in question. It's not as if we are awash with other primary destinations between Longtown and Hoyk, nor are there other communities between Kirkpatrick, Fleming and Langholm championing the case to be put on motorway road signs. When you consider the disruption associated with having a trunk road roar through the high street of your small town, it doesn't seem that big an ask to me that the responsible authorities would be willing to acknowledge that the route actually goes through your community. What's more, I believe there is an obligation on Transport Scotland and operators to get more involved in helping promote these communities as somewhere to stop, visit and return to. It's not good enough just to punt this on to communities themselves and expect them to navigate the bureaucracy that Visit Scotland has created around brown signage on the trunk road network. Presiding Officer, as I close today, I would ask the Minister to reflect on what more can be done to get behind Langholm to remove these roadblocks. Our smaller, more rural and remote communities have every bit as much to offer and are primary destinations for those who live there and the many visitors they attract. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Mundell. We move to the open debate. I call first Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Brian Whittle. Around 4 minutes, Mr MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And Oliver Mundell's probably thinking I'm a surprise contributor to this debate, but I am absolutely delighted. And I want to thank him for bringing forward the motion to the Parliament. And I think, actually, he's achieving his aims of the motion even by bringing this to the Parliament, because I've had to learn a wee bit about Langholm today, and I'm sure others are, so well done to you for that. I'm mainly actually speaking on behalf of my colleague Emma Harper, who, as Oliver Mundell has said, would have spoken today, but she is out the Parliament and other business. She's absolutely gutted, actually, to have missed it, and she's asked me to relay some points, some of which Oliver Mundell has already done, but broadly that she agrees with everything that Oliver Mundell has in his motion. She talks about Langholm as a community, a very close-knit community that supports each other and this desire for better signage. She also stresses that Transport, in her view, she feels that Transport Scotland need to review their policy on directing people to destinations and that Langholm should be a place that people are pointed to go to rather than, you know, a village that is just driven through. And she also told me the story about Neil Armstrong, which I think is absolutely a fascinating bit of history there. So that has been great to learn about that. And Langholm just does sound a great place. And, you know, I do, I will be making efforts to visit it myself. As somebody that travels across Scotland with my kids, I think they'll definitely like some of the history there. Particularly as one of my children's very into space stuff just now, I think they'll really like that. On the broader issue of signage, I think we can all agree in our constituencies it's very, very important, because unless you're in Glasgow or Edinburgh or perhaps some of the other cities north of the Central Belt, you sometimes feel like your tourist attractions and such like can be missed out. And there's plenty within the Coatbridge and Cryston area, I have to say, that the signage on the two major motorways surrounding my constituency are okay. On the M80, there's plenty of signage for things within Coatbridge and the Northern Corridor area. But it did take actually the upgrading of the M8 just a few years ago to have improved signage there, which has been really important, highlighting places like the Time Capsule, Summer Lee Museum in Coatbridge, and also Auchengeek Memorial on the other side, as I said, the other motorway and the Northern Corridor. So signage is very important, because I think it's important that all Scotland benefits from tourism, whether it's a small town like Langholm or a medium-sized town and constituency like Coatbridge and Cryston, and that it's not, you know, it's not just focused on Glasgow and Edinburgh, as important as those cities are to us, and I use both regularly myself. But I think the ethos of today's debate around about signage is very, very important. And I do thank Transport Scotland for the signage for my constituency being in pretty good shape just now. So I'll just end, presiding officer, as a brief contribution by going back to the work of Emma Harper and Oliver Dale, wishing both luck and the best of luck in their continuing efforts for Langholm, and I look forward to visiting Langholm myself and seeing and hearing more about it. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. And I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Colin Smith. Around 4 minutes, Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start by congratulating my friend and colleague Oliver Mundell for securing time in this chamber to promote the muckle tune that is Langholm. Now, Oliver Mundell highlighted many of the great characteristics of Langholm in his opening address, with many reasons that we should be visiting this town. Unsurprisingly, Deputy Presiding Officer, I would also like to mention the town's great sporting heritage, especially as it's steeped in Borders rugby folklore. Yes, I have travelled down to play rugby in the cauldron that is Langholm Rugby Club. The word passionate doesn't seem to cover the town's support, and yes, most of us got out alive. Oliver Mundell also highlighted that the town, like many communities in the south of Scotland and in rural Scotland as a whole, especially in the southwest, are poorly serviced by transport links. This is not a new topic in this place, as we in this party, and indeed members from across the chamber, have continually brought to the attention of the Scottish Government. It makes it difficult to attract businesses as well as visitors to these areas. If it is difficult to get goods in and out of rural Scotland, if it's difficult to get workers in and out of rural Scotland, if it's difficult to access services, then the attraction that rural Scotland undoubtedly offers in communities like Langholm becomes difficult to justify for businesses and families. Migration is such a hot topic at the moment. However, the Scottish Government have conveniently forgotten about the huge migratory issues that Scotland has in terms of migration from rural to urban, or even west to east. In the last 10 years, migration numbers from west of Scotland to the east of Scotland is the equivalent of the population of the area of Inverclyde. Moreover, much of that migration is from rural areas to urban areas. Migration rural to urban is reducing the need for services, leading to more expensive services to deliver, which in turn leads to the reduction in provision of those services. Schools, healthcare, community sport and leisure are all services that local councils are increasingly struggling to maintain. Class sizes reduced to a point where there are fewer and fewer teachers, leading to more composite classes or even the closure of some schools. Rural schools and GP practices are struggling to recruit enough teachers and GP practices are struggling to recruit enough teachers and GPs to service these communities. Accessing hospital care, especially emergency care, is precarious at best, with accidents on trunk roads often necessitating huge diversions onto B roads, B class roads. Layer on top of that, the rural housing policy that does nothing to deliver rural housing, and the Scottish Government are presiding over a perfect storm. It is no wonder that rural Scotland is struggling to maintain its rural communities. Scottish Government policy has for many years been biased towards urban communities and their needs to the detriment of communities like Langholm. The lack of investment in our rural communities, detailed by Oliver Mundell, is continuing to cause a population drain as it becomes increasingly difficult to deliver the connectivity and the services that will reverse this trend. Deputy Presiding Officer, if the Scottish Government continue to starve our rural communities of investment into the transport infrastructure, and let's face it, less than 0.05% of the Scottish transport budget in the last decade has been invested in the south of Scotland, then the inevitable conclusion will be a Scotland that is increasingly urban-based, and fantastic communities like Langholm, steeped in such rich Scottish history, will fade away. And wouldn't that be a travesty, Deputy Presiding Officer? So I'd once again like to thank Oliver Mundell for giving us the opportunity to speak on this topic in the Chamber. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. I now call Colin Smith to be followed by Rachel Hamilton. Around 4 minutes, Mr Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Oliver Mundell for tabling his motion. It's a welcome opportunity to shine a light on a town that's often forgotten, but one whose community drive, passion, achievements are an example to others. Langholm was the birthplace of engineer Thomas Telford, the poet Hugh MacDiarmid. As home of Clan Armstrong, as we've heard, it proudly made Neil Armstrong the first and indeed only Freeman of Langholm on his visit in 1972, when he warmly told the crowds, "I consider this now my hometown." The Muckle Toon has a proud, rich history. It was once a thriving economy with a population of over 4,000 and bustling textile mills. But the economic decline of the 80s halved the population. The big employers closed or left town. The last Edinburgh Woolen Mill, founded in Langholm in 1946, moved its head office to Carlisle 5 years ago. Despite this decline, despite the challenges, however, the community is fighting back. They recognise the opportunities that exist in Langholm, from a focus on ecotourism to making the town a hub for small, growing businesses. I spoke recently in Parliament about the quiet land reform revolution taking place on Langholm Moor. The Moor's dramatic hills, native woodland habitat and stunning river valley are home to some of the best sites to see hen harriers and curlew, and they're right on the doorstep of the town of Langholm. So when the Duke of Buccleuch declared the Moor surplus to his vast land portfolio in 2019, the community, through the Langholm Initiative, undertook a bold fundraising effort which put the town on the map. It captured hearts around the world, and it raised a remarkable £6 million to undertake South Scotland's biggest community buyout, taking 10,000 hectares of the Duke's land under the protection and ownership of the people. Now known as the Tarras Valley Nature Reserve, the community owners are improving the environment by pushing the boundaries of ecological and community restoration in partnership with organisations such as the Woodland Trust and John Moore Trust, and building a far better economic future for Langholm by pursuing sustainable and responsible tourism. Their vision, Presiding Officer, their plans for the Moor are inspiring, and they sum up the community spirit that drives Langholm. That optimism has also been captured by the Langholm Alliance and their community plan for the town, an ambitious but I believe entirely achievable long-term plan that aims to give the town a thriving, sustainable economy by 2030, including bringing more visitors to the area to enjoy the Moor and everything that Langholm has to offer. But the Alliance have rightly, as we've heard, identified that it makes it that bit more difficult to put Langholm on the map when Transport Scotland seem to have such difficulty even putting it on the road signs. Thanks to the Alliance's campaign, we are seeing some progress south of the border, with proposals from the UK Government for new signage to Langholm on the roundabout at Junction 44 on the M6, and from Cumberland Council for signage on the A7. But the Scottish Government does need to show more flexibility and a bit more common sense and play its part with far better signage to Langholm on the A7 and the M74 north of the border. And the Alliance have set out exactly, Minister, where this could be achieved. So I hope, Minister, you will respond to those calls positively in your closing comments and review the current outdated policy that does hold communities such as Langholm back. Presiding Officer, the Alliance's plan also rightly backs calls by the Langholm and District Rail Group that any feasibility study on extending the Borders Railway should include consideration of the route passing through Langholm. The case to extend the line to Langholm to Hoyock is powerful. Further south is more challenging because there are fewer major population centres. And while there is a strong argument for extending the line to Carlisle to link with the West Coast mainline and provide that alternative to the East Coast mainline, I think the case for that extension would be even stronger if Langholm was included on the route, given that it is the largest town between Hoyock and Carlisle. That, Presiding Officer, along with proper signage on the A7 and A74, is something that really would put Langholm on the map.
Thank you, Mr Smith. I now call Rachel Hamilton, final speaker in the open debate. Up to 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I firstly thank Oliver Mundell for bringing forward this really great debate and for his fantastic speech. But not to be outdone by him, I too completed the Selkirk Common Riding on horseback, and my horse was going so fast that I had to tuck myself right behind Stuart Coulthard, who at the time was a previous standard bearer for Selkirk. And it was the most frightening experience of my life, and thank goodness we were going up the Three Brethren. It was just worse coming down. But I would like to, like Oliver has done, challenge my colleague Brian Whittle to join me.
Nope.
And whilst Langholm is not in my constituency, of course I represent the neighbouring communities across the borders, for example Newcastleton, and Newcastleton is closer to Langholm than it is to Hoyock, and the children of Newcastleton go to the Hoyock, to the Langholm school, and some go to the Hoyock school. But also, Langholm, as Oliver Mundell has said, has much in common with its neighbouring town Hoyock, because it has a common riding, and I support the common ridings. And Tommy Morrison from Langholm was in the car with me as we drove round Hoyock, waving to everyone as all the townsfolk came out. And I thought that they were waving at me and saying hello, but no, it was Tommy Morrison from Langholm. So I've just given him a shout out because he was far more popular than I was. But the core of this debate is about ensuring that we give communities the right tools and support to allow them to thrive. And as many speakers have said this evening, we absolutely need to ensure that we don't just get people to drive through areas onto other places, that we ensure that they come and enjoy the fantastic towns and attractions that we have on our doorstep. For Langholm and across the south of Scotland, tourism is a key part of the local economy. As of March this year, there were just over 890 businesses directly involved in the visitor economy, employing thousands of people across the borders. And I draw members to the register of my interests as a director of a local hospitality business in the borders. There's 2 million day trips to the borders. That was in 2022. And our towns and the villages are the first to offer the best experience for tourists across that area. Millions visit the region every year to see such attractions such as Sir Walter Scott's Abbotsford and our historic Borders Abbeys. Sadly, however, it's easy for travellers, as others have said, to miss those key attractions whilst driving through the region and not enjoying what they have in the region because of the lack of effective signposting on roads such as the A7. And at this point, I would like to mention the A7 Action Group, because they're a group of people who have consistently over the years campaigned to ensure that signage is improved on that A7 corridor. I also met with famously Hoyock. It's a group of 5 retailers. They're premium luxury retailers who promote their local attractions and improve the visitor experience of the town. So producers such as Johnson's of Elgin, the Borders Distillery, Hoyococo, William Lockie and Lovett Mill. And their concern was that there was a lack of strategic approach to welcoming signage in the town and along the A7, which was resulting in missed opportunities for visitors. So I agree with other speakers that improved signage along the A7 would undoubtedly provide a valuable boost to them and others in places like Hoyt and Langholm. And finally, I just want to make the point, Presiding Officer, that I was really disappointed by Visit Scotland's decision to shut down the eye centres. The eye centre in Jedburgh will be shut down. And I don't think that the Scottish Government at this stage and this juncture after COVID can afford to take the visitor economy for granted. Our communities are proud of their heritage and culture, and it is only right that the Scottish Government do more to boost these communities and to save those really iconic and special visitor centres. Thank you to Oliver. Let's just try to do more and get the Government to engage with communities by implementing effective signposting to local attractions and businesses. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. I now call on Jim Fairley to respond to the debate. Minister, around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, can I first of all congratulate Oliver Mundell on bringing forward this motion today, and just to recognise the efforts of many, including my colleague Emma Harper, in making sure that Langholm as a community are heard in creating opportunities for their town as a destination in the Borders, and to emphasise that we in the Government recognise the strategic importance that our towns and villages make in ensuring that Scotland is a destination in itself, with a huge diversity. Be it cityscapes, landscapes or cultural heritage, Scotland really does offer it all. For Langholm itself, I would add to the recognitions of the various members about the attractions to Langholm and highlight again things like being called the Muckledoon, being called the Muckletoon and growing cannabis. That to me is a reason to get a brown board sign up in the roads anyway, the fact that you're growing cannabis and called the Muckletoon. It's the birthplace of Hugh McDermott. It sits on the River Esk in the beautiful another beautiful Scottish attraction. Its connection to the Reavers, and I romantically like to think of the Reavers as being of independent mind and spirit. And as they were talking about the common ridings, just seeing Emma Harper on a horse going through Langholm itself, that in itself would be worth a visit to Langholm, Presiding Officer. Its undoubted fame and association of the Gilnockie Tower to Clan Armstrong and to the making of Neil Armstrong a freeman of the town in 1973. Add to that the Buccleuch Centre and, of course, the Langholm Moor Raptor Study. There are endless reasons for folk wanting to visit the town, which I'm sure is very welcomed by the residents and tourist businesses alike. And it's for all those reasons that it's clearly worth having this debate for the members and the people of Langholm. However, as far as the road sign is concerned, which is the foundation of Mr Mundell's motion, there are many things to consider, and lots of years of work and consultation have been devoted to Langholm. So I'd like to revise some of those points in my closing remarks to the debate. This is what Transport Scotland's approach has been and its current position with road signage policy. For Langholm on the A7 Trunk Road, Transport Scotland has held various discussions over the years with local representatives, including MSPs and MPs, the members of the Langholm Alliance, Dumfries and Galloway Council, a number of the road authorities from the North West England and the UK's Department of Transport. They have confirmed that they believe the current strategic signing arrangements for Langholm are consistent with the national applied strategy. The Trunk Road signing policy governs the directional signage on trunk roads in Scotland and throughout the strategic road network of the UK. Yes, I will.
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Minister for taking the intervention and for the start to his speech, but this is kind of more of the same of what we've had. And it seems very hard to believe that Cumbria County Council and National Highways are able to get Langholm onto road signs just south of the border. But when it comes to Scotland, these technical requirements are stopping it. And as I said during my own remarks, it seems odd because there are no other primary destinations. These signs can have up to six destinations on them, but there aren't six destinations, so there is space. It seems a shame to hide behind technical requirements.
Minister, I can give you the time back.
Well, I'm going to complete the point that I was making, because a detailed review of the existing signage on strategic roads has been conducted, resulting in Langholm's inclusion on Northland signs on the A7 within England and additional signs on the A75 to the east of Dumfries. Signage on the A74 motorway was also examined last year to evaluate the feasibility of incorporating Langholm onto the existing signs, but it was determined that the existing signage on the motorway complies with current design requirements. And it's important to acknowledge that the motorway signs in question are relatively new, large and expensive to replace. Consequently, it has been deemed prudent to defer consideration of this opportunity until the signs require replacement at the end of their serviceable life. There are currently no immediate plans to modify the A74 signs, and this has been advised to Mr Mundell in previous responses to parliamentary questions. And it should be noted that other policies exist for the consideration of new brown tourist destination signage. And if I want to talk about cannabis, there you go. This aims to promote businesses and attractions who are accredited throughout Visit Scotland's quality assurance scheme. And with the wealth of attractions I mentioned, perhaps that is something the member can explore with his constituents. Transport Scotland's approach to the Langholm signage issue has been thorough and thoughtful, and I can advise that in following engagement with the local community and stakeholders over the preceding year, that the Langholm sign rationalisation initiative has been effectively executed along the A7 trunk road. That initiative seeks to enhance the pedestrian experience and to reduce visual clutter by minimising the number of signs, and has resulted in the optimisation of available foot space throughout Langholm. Looking ahead to this year, the focus will be addressing the community's request for new signage. Now, these requests include signage for community facilities, catering for both motorists and pedestrians, as well as provisions for parking, including electric vehicle charging facilities and gateway signage. Through ongoing collaboration, this initiative will optimise the signage within Langholm whilst ensuring efficient use of space to address the community's needs and their requests. Through Transport Scotland's road maintenance contracts, significant investment in the A7 has been made, totalling £64 million since 2007. These investments include various initiatives such as routine and cyclic maintenance, deeper road reconstruction, general minor improvement measures, active travel works, road safety enhancements and bridge maintenance. In the recent financial year, a total of £6.6 million has been invested in the A7 for road maintenance. That funding has been directed towards projects such as the improvement of road markings and studs between Langholm and Hawick, as part of the ongoing efforts to improve the overall infrastructure and safety standards of the A7 corridor. In terms of our continued investment, there are currently two significant resurfacing schemes scheduled for this year along the A7. The first is situated north of Langholm, and it's estimated at £130,000 and is programmed for the autumn 2024, with the second one to the south of Langholm, estimated to cost £970,000, is scheduled for the winter of 2024. The Scottish Government has made a commitment to implement 20 mile an hour speed limits on roads where deemed appropriate by 2025. And that was a commitment that was reinforced in the 2022 programme for government, which advocates for the expansion of 20 mile per hour zones to create safer streets and promote active travel. As part of this initiative, the A7 at Langholm has been identified as a potential location for reducing the speed limit from 30 to 20 in sections meeting the specific criteria. Transport Scotland is collaborating with Dumfries and Galloway Council and Police Scotland to advance new 20 mph speed limits where deemed suitable. In the upcoming year, Transport Scotland has committed to enhancing end-to-end footway accessibility throughout Langholm Town Centre with the objective of offering the most optimal walking and wheeling facilities within the area, as well as continued support for discussions around the signage with aforementioned groups such as Langholm Alliance and the Tourism Officer. Transport Scotland and its road maintenance operating company Bayer participates in all seven action group meetings to foster close communication and collaboration with the communities, including Langholm. I'm going to push on because I'm already over my time. Additionally, as part of their commitment to social value and community benefits, Bayer Scotland has proactively engaged with schools in the area. This outreach has been conducted both in person and online, ensuring a comprehensive coverage and accessibility. Furthermore, the community has been provided with ongoing assistance for road network access during special community events, such as the Christmas lights display and the Langholm Bonfire and Fireworks event. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, with all that in mind, I'd like to conclude by reiterating the Government's unwavering commitment to all the aspects raised in the motion, ensuring that the A7 trunk road continues to support economic development in the south-east of Scotland and indeed across Scotland. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate that I suspect Emma Harper will be watching back tomorrow with no little alarm, but I close this meeting of Parliament.